We started early. It was great. That's why we started at 8, so we have a little bit of breather time. So we'll see you. Cool. Thanks, guys. Great work.
That was okay for you?
Yeah. Do you guys like that? Thanks, tech people.
That's the color there.
Just looking at the license.
the night out. Just make it all.
I'll try to remember that. Thanks.
What is it?
No.
Where she's dancing?
No. Everyone, we're glad you're here. Let's stand together. As we have our worship time together, we're going to sing a great song called Hear Our Praises. be filled with dancing. May our streets be filled with joy. May injustice bow to Jesus. As the people turn to pray. Together again, church.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Yeah. Hallelujah. All together.
From the mountains to the valleys, hear our praises rise to you. From the heavens to the nations, hear our singing. Rise to you.
the Lord. Amen. Great song.
Great singing. Great singing. Yes.
We love this song. It's kind of a echo song. So the guys will sing and the girls will echo. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Oh, worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow. Glad you're with us today here in person and online and wherever else you might find yourself this morning. But we're glad you're here, and thanks for wearing your masks. Kind of a big deal, but we're glad you're here, and we're distant socially. And so anyway, I'm going to pray and open our service. Lord, thank you for a gorgeous morning, and we thank you for your provision and your care for us. In these strange times, in these very difficult times for so many, we worship you, God, as you're above governments and you're above the earth. And your ways are different than our ways, and you don't change. You are faithful and true, and we just want to say we worship you today, and we put every ounce of our trust in you in these times. We need you. We need you, God, to help us as a people and help us as individuals. And so we love you, and please accept our praise. You're worthy of all our praise, and we love singing to you, and we know you love hearing our praises. So Thank you, Lord, for your presence, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing another song here. It's a great song that proclaims God's greatness.
Promise maker, promise keeper, will you finish what you begin? Our provision through the days of life, you see it through till the end. You see it through till the end.
Be seated. We're going to have our prayer time now. We're going to pray for a global prayer point. Iran. We're going to pray for Iran. Now let's run the video first. Mm-hmm.
Well, what would typically happen right now is, you know, say a house meeting, a house Bible study or a house church meeting is raided by the police. They would take pictures of everyone who's there. They would take down identity documents, take pictures of their, you know, driver's license or ID. The people, though, who would get arrested would be the people who were leading the meeting. And so they want to, like you say, they've kind of realized, I think, we can't arrest everyone who's following Christ in Iran. There's just too many of them. So let's arrest the leaders. Let's arrest those who are giving out Bibles, who are sharing the gospel, who are encouraging more Muslims to become apostates by following Jesus Christ. So the leaders are often taken to jail. And, you know, they may or may not be put on trial. They may or may not go to court. But even if they're let go on bail, the charges are never dropped. And so what that means is, hey, if we catch you at another church meeting, not only will you be charged for that meeting, but we'll keep going with these charges as well. So many Christian leaders have actually had to flee the country under that kind of pressure. What often happens when bail is put up, they will take the deed to your house or the deed to your parents' house as your bail. And then they say, hey, if we find you at any more Christian meetings, we're going to take away your parents' house. They won't have a place to live anymore. So that's the kind of pressure they're putting. And again, the focus is on leaders and on those sharing the gospel rather than every single person who they catch at a Christian meeting.
So we're going to pray now for the country of Iran. And if you're able to kneel here or at home, we need to humble ourselves. We want to get God's attention, show that we're serious. And not just our country, but other countries are really struggling. And so, Lord, we just want to bow and kneel before you. And we, first of all, thank you for the growth of the church in Iran. We thank you that many tens of thousands are finding their purpose and understanding your great love for mankind, and we pray for more and more to come to that type of love. We pray, Lord, for those who are suffering, who are under threat, who are in hiding, families who have been separated, people who have lost jobs, people who are in jail, people who are missing, people who are in prison. We pray now, Lord, that you would bring comfort and peace right now, just this afternoon, this evening, right now in Iran. We pray for your comforting Holy Spirit to give them hope for a better day and give them boldness and strength to be faithful. And finally, Lord, we pray for those who are inflicting the persecution, the government, the clerics. We pray for their hearts to be touched. We don't pray for harm for them. We pray that they would come to the knowledge of Christ and surrender their lives. We pray that the veil that the devil has put over so many would be torn away, and they would see, God, they would see your Son, Jesus, for who he is, your Son, the Savior of the world. So hear our prayers this morning for those in Iran. We pray, Lord, we call on your great name. Just your name, God, will bring about victory. And Lord, would you bring about victory, because you're stronger, you're above, you're greater than anything has been created. And we believe that. We humbly ask you to exert your power, Lord, to change hearts, to tear away the veils of deception, hatred, violence. Or we can't have that. That's so evil. Please, Lord, help those millions of people living in Iran today. Or lay your hand over that land and heal the land and bring about great revival in the hierarchy of the government and the religious. We pray and we trust you, God. We know that's your will. We pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This candle is a symbol of our prayers and our praises that go to heaven. Let's just close out our time here before our message and sing this chorus to this song.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
sing it together, church.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, what could stand against? If our God is for us, stop us. And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? What could stand?
Be seated. Amen. Thank you, church. Thank you, church.
It's our time. We must rise up and no longer disparage. It's our time, church, to honor our heritage. We have a Savior. He gave it all on the cross. We stand beside martyrs who counted nothing as loss. They took God's mysteries, opened them up for us. Stephen, John the Baptist, Bonhoeffer, Jan Hus. Surrounded by a cloud of witnesses above, it's now our turn to model his unending love. Our mission is one we cannot confuse, nor muddy up with some trite excuse. You say you're not well-versed, ready, or able. I think Moses even tried to use that fable. The time we have, it's now more urgent. If we should hear, well done, faithful servant. Yeah, church, it's our time. It's our time to confess the ways we're mangled, the sins and selfishness that have us entangled. Lust, greed, and pride, their path leads to the grave. Yet we return to our sins as if we're a slave. Can we survive in this putrid Dead Sea? I quote Paul, may it never be. So let's cast aside our individual leprosy and begin to leave a biblical legacy. There's a glorious prize awaiting to be won, and the way to win is to start to run. Let's lace them up and fight the good fight, become to the world both salt and light. Our life on earth is merely a vapor. Our chapter must move from pen to paper. So church, let's get to writing because it's our time. It's our time, church. We have what it takes. to help the world from its slumber awake. To Jesus, we are his beautiful bride. Whom shall we fear with him on our side? We have each other, we are not alone. It's iron to iron in the combat zone. There's a promise of life full of adventure. As long as we give both talents and treasure, the workers are few, the harvest is plenty, with so many lives running on empty. Scores of people trying to cope, they've come to the end of their proverbial rope. Young eyes are wandering, looking for direction. Make sure we point them to his resurrection. The clock's ticking, we're on our dime. Hey church, rise up, it's our time.
It's our time. It's our time. In these uncertain times that we're living in, it's the church's time to shine, to step into the chaos, and to proclaim a gospel message. And that's the purpose of the book of Hebrews. As we've been walking through this book, we've been looking, and he's been making a case. You have these believers, these people who surrendered their life to Christ, and now they're wondering, did we make the right decision? With the persecution that's happening, when the world is falling apart around us, did we make the right decision to follow Jesus? And the author takes us through. He says, yes, don't, whatever you do, do not let go of Jesus. I know you don't know what today brings, what tomorrow brings, what next week brings, what next year brings, but do not let go of Jesus. Remember, Jesus is your deliverer. He will see you through. Remember that Jesus is the one who gives you rest. Remember that Jesus gives you help. Remember that Jesus sustains you by his word. Don't go back. Don't go back to your old life. Remember, there was a reason that you left your old life. Don't go back. Remember that when everything is falling apart, Jesus is the anchor for your soul. Don't go back. Remember that Jesus is the one that brings you peace, that gives you his peace, that gives you his righteousness. Don't go back. Remember that Jesus offers you a covenant relationship. A covenant relationship, a relationship that's not based on your feelings, but that is based on the word of Christ. And Jesus keeps his promises. Remember, don't go back. You are in a covenant relationship with him. Don't go back. And last week we looked and we said this, we remember that Jesus appeared. We believe in a God that is not distant, that he is imminent, that he is here, that he is with us, and he appeared. He appeared in history when he put on flesh, when he walked, when he taught, when he performed miracles, when he was arrested, when he was crucified. But then he rose again. Jesus appeared in history to put an end to sin. And Jesus right now, he appeared. He is appearing in heaven on our behalf. He is interceding for the believer. He is going to sustain you. And we wait for his appearance again. We wait, we trust that at some point he will appear again and he will bring us home. The new heavens and the new earth. Don't go back. It's our time. I know it looks uncertain. I know it looks like the world is falling apart around us, but we trust that God still has the world in his hands. And through this chaos, it is an opportunity for the church. And so if you have your Bible, turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10. And here's what he's doing. This author, whoever it is, the unknown author, he takes the first half of the book, Hebrews 1 through 10, and he says, this is who you are in Christ. This is who you are in Christ. This is what you have in Christ. But then he turns and he says, okay, now that we've established your identity, here's how you put it into use. Now that we've narrowed it down, this is who you have. These are the riches. These are the blessings, the heavenly blessings that God has poured out into your life. This is who you are in Christ. Here's what this means on Monday. Here's what this means as you're going through the turmoil, through the tribulation. And so he points this out in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4. He says this, for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. And he goes on a little bit further in verse 11. He says this, "And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins." And his point is that in the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, none of that actually took away sin. What it did is it pointed to a better sacrifice that was to come. It was a covering. It was a covering for the people. And what it did was it cleansed the outside of a person to make them ceremonially clean. But it never addressed their conscience. It never addressed their soul. It never addressed what really matters. It pointed to a sacrifice that would. And so what the author is saying is, look, we're stepping out of that into the new covenant. And here's what he says. Look at this. In verse 10, or chapter 10, verse 12, he says this. "But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. By a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified." You have been cleansed. If you have surrendered your life to Christ, he has perfected you. That's how he sees you. He sees you through the righteousness of Jesus. He has perfected you, but he also recognizes that you are being sanctified. So there's this moment when we surrender our life to Christ because of the blood of Jesus where he says, you are complete. And then he continues to sanctify us that we become more and more and more like Jesus as we walk with him. I love this quote by Watchman Nee. He says, "It is God's holiness, God's righteousness, which demands that a sinless life should be given for man. There is life in the blood, and that blood has to be poured out for me, for my sins. God is the one who requires it to be so. So God is the one who demands that blood be presented in order to satisfy his own righteousness. And it is he who says, 'When I see blood, I will pass over you.' The blood of Christ wholly satisfies God." That is what we are hanging on to. That's the culmination of this. Chapters 1 through 10 come to this pinnacle, to this conclusion that says we are accepted not because of the blood of goats and bulls, but because of the blood of Christ. And that blood covers our sin. But more than that, look at this in chapter 10, verse 19 and 21. It says, "Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence..." 19. "Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us, through the curtain that is through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God." The blood is satisfying to Christ, and therefore it must be satisfying to us. A clear conscience can never be dependent on what we have done. It's always dependent upon the work of Christ. It's always dependent upon the work that he did by dying for our sins and the blood that he offers in the true tabernacle to cover our sins. It cleanses us from all sins. The big sins that we think of when we think about sin, the small sins that we don't give any thought to. Even sins, I can't believe how many times I get this as having been a preacher for a while, and how many people have said, "Oh, God would never forgive me." Yeah, even those sins. It reminds me of the old hymn writer, Robert Lowry, when he says this. He says, "What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And once we have been identified in that, once we have surrendered our life to Christ, once we have said, you know what, I believe Jesus came, he died for me, once we confess, once we are in agreement with God that I am a sinner and I have rebelled against God, once we have repented, God, it's not my life, but it's your life. Once he has sealed us with his Spirit, you're a new creation in Christ. You are new in him. You are cleansed in him. You have moved from darkness to light. You have moved from dead to alive in him. All because of the blood of Christ. And so the author turns and he says, okay, now that you have that new life, there's a new way to live. There's a new way to move forward. Because God didn't save you. God didn't rescue you to put you on a shelf somewhere, as in a museum somewhere, and tuck you away. No, he has saved you. He has redeemed you to be an influence for this world. And there is a new way. And so what it comes down to is this: in uncertain times, with the blood of Christ, it's our time. And the author goes on and he says this: let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us draw near. Let us draw near. The throne room of grace is open. You see, a lot of people, they think that God is up on a cloud somewhere with a lightning bolt that is ready to strike them anytime they make a mistake. That's not what this is saying. Suther says, no, it's not like that. You have a heavenly Father who loves you and cares for you and wants to be involved in your life. You don't have to fear God because you are a child of God. You have surrendered your life to him. There's a new relationship. Before you surrendered your life to Christ, the Bible says that you were an enemy to God. But once you surrendered your life to Christ, you become adopted into his family, bought with his blood. The new way for you is not to have this fearful, oh, God is going to get me mentality, but no, God is for you. And you have access to his throne. You can draw near to him anytime. You don't need to go through a preacher. You don't need to go through a worship leader. You don't need to go through an elder. Right now, you can stop and you can pray and you say, God, I need you. And he will be there for you. You have access to the throne room. The God who spoke things into existence. The God who calls out the stars by name. The God who told the mountains you would be this high, the valleys you would be this low, the God who stops the ocean at the shoreline, the God who knows everything. You can go into his throne room. You don't have to fear because you are his child. In uncertain times, with the blood of Christ, it's our time. And so the author says, not only do you have this incredible access to this throne room, not only do you have that you have the ability to draw near with a true heart, with your conscience clean, but look at what else he says in verse 23. He says this: let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. It sounds like a little bit of a warning. In these uncertain times, as things are coming at you, there could be a tendency to drift away. There could be a tendency to say, you know what, I'm not sure if I made the right decision by following Christ. And so he encourages the reader, he encourages this church, he encourages these people who have surrendered their life to Christ in the midst of persecution, in the midst of uncertainty, don't let go of Jesus. Hold fast to the confession of hope that you have, because you're going to have tribulations. You're going to have trials. And it appears in Scripture, when I read Scripture, it seems that there's three different attacks that are used. Here's the first one, is that we are in a spiritual battle. Why is it that the moment that you decide that you're going to go deeper with your relationship with Christ, everything falls apart? Do you think that's a coincidence? Why is it that you can wake up at 5 a.m. every single morning, come Sunday morning, and 11 o'clock looks early? There's a spiritual battle. The Bible tells us that Satan is prowling like a lion, ready to pounce. He wants to kill you. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus has come to give life. Why is that? So there's one. Hold fast, because Satan is attacking. Satan is attacking your spiritual walk. Satan is attacking your marriages. Satan is attacking your kids. Satan is attacking your family. Satan is attacking. You are in a spiritual battle. And he will do everything in his power to take the blessings away from you that Christ has given to you. You are in a spiritual battle. Hold fast though, because guess what? There's tribulation and persecution that is happening. Not only is Satan attacking, we are in a broken world. We are in a broken world. Right now, we have seen this. Can you believe that this week we turn the page and we move from the first half of the year to the second half of the year? It's been so crazy that, I don't know about you, but I have forgotten that in Salt Lake City that we went through the earthquakes. Do you remember those couple weeks? This world is broken. The Bible tells us that the world itself groans in agony, waiting for the sons of God to be revealed. Hold fast. Hold fast your confession of hope, because Satan is attacking, and not only is Satan attacking, but we live in a broken world where the earth shakes and viruses hit. But here's the one that gets me. I'm still wrestling with my flesh. I'm still wrestling with my flesh. You see, it's easy for me to look at the world and say, okay, well, Satan's attacking. It's easy for me to look at the world and say, okay, you know what? The world is shaking. But I've got a bigger problem than Satan attacking and the world shaking, and that's my flesh. You see, what happens when we surrender our life to Christ, God renews us in our spirit. He makes us a new creation. He says, that's it. You have been justified. It's not that you're innocent, but that you have been declared innocent. And you get to experience that new life. However, we are waiting for our flesh to be redeemed. And so because we still have our flesh, we can put to death the deeds of the body. We can put to death the deeds of the flesh by focusing on the things of the Spirit. But the problem is that I don't always want to focus on the things of the Spirit. Sometimes I want to focus on the things of this world the deceitfulness of riches, the desires of things other than the kingdom. So we have this three-pronged approach of the distraction from the kingdom. We have Satan attacking, we have the earth shaking, but we also are dealing with our own flesh. And so the author encourages you, he encourages me, hold fast to your confession of hope. You can enter the throne room. You have access. And whatever you do, do not let go of Jesus. Hold fast to your confession. And then he comes to verse 24. And I'm so grateful for this verse. It says this, it says, And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as are the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. I'm so grateful for the church. I'm so grateful for the body of Christ that encourages, that lifts each other up. And when we serve one another in love, it builds the body up. But it seems like the author is giving a little bit of a warning here. He says, look, your tendency when persecution hits, when tribulation hits, when you are being attacked by Satan, when the world is shaking with COVID and racism and all that other stuff, and when your own sin gets in the way, there's going to be a tendency for the believers in Christ to back away. And so what he says, what he calls his church to do is not back away, but to gather. I can't tell you how much I've appreciated Southeast Christian Church the last 6 months. I just cannot tell you how much I appreciate you. And here's why. Because you guys have been intentional about gathering. Not necessarily in person, but online. Man, I really felt when this first thing, when this hit and we said, you know what, it's not safe for us to meet. We need to figure things out. And we kind of backed off. We said, you know what, let's figure this out. I felt the tension. Mike, you need to start a Bible study online. Mike, you need to start a Bible study online. And you know what I did? I paused. You know why? Because all of our group leaders jumped online. They said, hey, we got it covered. We got it covered. Everything that we've been putting out, the church, Southeast Christian Church, you've been so receptive. And I know that it kind of goes from person to person and it's difficult. And especially now, we were talking about it earlier in a prayer meeting this morning with some of the elders. And some of us, and I don't know if you feel this way, but man, I'm zoomed out. Anybody else feel that? Where if you look at one more screen, your head just might explode. And what this is saying is, it says, no, you need to be intentional. Don't let excuses get in the way of being in a connection. And I don't think the author had in mind here a worship service. I think what the author had in mind is, as persecution hits and the church is scattered, you've got to be intentional about making sure that you're still connecting with people within the body. And so don't let people use this as a guilt trip to say, hey, you know what? You haven't been in worship service. That's not what this is talking about. What this is talking about is making sure that the relationships are still happening outside of the scheduled programming. Because it's a beautiful thing when we serve each other and the church builds itself up in love. That's the way that God intended it. So as Satan's attacking, as the world is shaking, as we're dealing with our own sin, let us stir. Let us stir each other up to encourage one another. Now, a lot of times what happens is that when we read these passages, we kind of look at it and say, we kind of evaluate ourselves. And we say, have I been involved in the church? And that's a good thing to do. But let me take it one step further. Who do you need to reach out to? Who do you need to reach out to and say, hey, you know what? God hasn't forgotten about you, and I haven't forgotten about you either. Because here's the problem. When you are feeling overwhelmed with Satan attacking, with the world shaking, with your own sin, oftentimes what happens is you're not looking at anything else but your own sin, and you need somebody to break in and say, you are not forgotten, and I've got you. So who in the congregation do you need to look to and say, you know what? I haven't heard from them for a while. I need to reach out to them. That's your challenge this week. But here's the thing. It's this whole thing that we have access to the throne room. We have access to the throne room. But not only do we have access to the throne room, he encourages to hold fast to this confession of faith because it's going to get shaky. But remember, we've got the body of Christ as well as a dynamic force in this world. But then he goes on and he gives this warning. He gives this warning. In other words, hey, you have this incredible relationship with Christ. Remember, he's better than the angels. He's better than Moses. He offers a better sacrifice. Not only a better sacrifice, a better covenant. You are in him. You have this. You have the church that's behind you. But here's the warning. Look at this in Hebrews chapter 26 through 27. Look at what he says. For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Don't go back. Again, it's another warning. You left your old life. Don't let go of Jesus. There's no sacrifice there. There's no forgiveness of sins over there. There's no heavenly blessings over there. Don't go back. And some of you are experiencing this right now. The fire of your faith is waning. You're exhausted because of the COVID. You're exhausted because of politics. You're exhausted because of, and you've kind of been just kind of going through the motions. And he gives this warning. He says, don't give up. Don't go back there. There's no sacrifice there. And he gives us these two tools, the kind of these two guardrails, if you will. Because if you're in this spot, if you're in this moment where, you know what, your faith is not on fire, where it's kind of like you have this, you still believe in Jesus, but you haven't felt alive in Jesus for a very long time, he gives you the antidote in the next two verses. Here's the first one. He says this, but recall the former days when after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. So the first instruction he gives is, hey, remember what it was like when you first became a Christian. If you feel that fire waning, if you feel like you're going to go back, if you're caught in sin, some addiction, remember where you came from. Remember the hope that you had. Remember, there is a reason that you surrendered your life to Christ. Because we come to Christ in moments of crisis. We've either lost a family member, or we've lost a marriage, or we've lost a job, or we got everything, but nothing seemed to satisfy, and we're in the pit, and we're saying, God, help me. And God comes and rescues us out of the pit. He pulls us out, and he says, okay, you are my child. And what he's saying here is that if you feel that waning, if you're caught in that sin, if your passion for Christ is going down, if the light is dimming in your heart, go back to that moment. Remember back when Jesus saved you initially. Come back to him. Remember where you came from. Remember where you came from. And then he does this, and then he gives us the next instruction, the next guardrail, the next how to get out of it verse. And look at what he says in verse 34. He says, For you had compassion on those in prison and joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Look at what he did. He says, remember your acts of service? Remember when you were going to visit the people in prison? Remember when they were taking property away from you and you trusted in your heavenly possessions? Go back to that. I think I heard this one time, and it might offend some of you, but that's okay. I think one of the difficulties with our relationships with Christ is that we have so much information coming at us. We have so much spirituality coming at us. And the problem is that we kind of sit in a sanctuary, or we sit at home consuming and consuming and consuming and consuming and consuming. We get in Bible study after Bible study after Bible study, and we're getting full and full and full, and we've become so spiritually obese that we can't walk out the door and serve our neighbor. What he's saying here is, when you surrendered your life to Christ, remember, you were there, you were in the fight. So what are you doing to serve? Oftentimes when I talk with somebody that is spiritually bankrupt, where they've come to a spot where they've said, you know what, Mike, I surrendered my life to Christ, but that fire has just waned. I mean, there's lots of different reasons that can happen for it, but probably the number one reason when I talk with people about that, it's because they're not doing anything with their faith. They're not putting it into practice. They're not going out to serve a neighbor or serve a family member or serve a stranger. It's just always intake, 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 intake. And then he goes on and he says, therefore, don't go back. Therefore, verses 10, 35 through 36, don't go back. And he says this, therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. You see, you have access to the throne of God because of the blood of Christ. You are a new creation because of the blood of Christ. You have been forgiven. Your spirit has been renewed. You are a new creation because of Christ. You are a new creation because of Christ. Let us draw near to him. Let us hold fast to our confession of hope. Let us stir each other up. But there's a warning. Do not go back. Because today is our time. Today is our time as the church. In uncertain times, with the blood of Christ, it's our time. And he finishes this off with verse 39. He says, but we are not those who shrink back and are destroyed, but those who have faith and persevere their souls. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. And if someone tells you that they do, you should probably cut them out of your life, because they're lying to you. But what I do know is that God is using this time. What I do know is that God uses uncertainty. What I do know is that God uses the brokenness in this world to show off his glory. And I know it might not feel like it. I know you might not see it, but God is working. And I don't know about you, but I am excited for the next week, for the next month, for the next couple years, as God's church emerges out of this crisis, not only of America, but out of the world. And I'm excited to see God's church shine. Not because of how great we are, but how great God is. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. God, you are so good to us. God, we thank you that we have access to your throne room of grace. God, we thank you that we can come before you and cast all our cares on you. But God, we also thank you that we can come and just offer you praise. God, we thank you that you never abandon us, that you strengthen us, that you have given to us a community of believers where we can serve each other and love each other and build each other up. God, I pray for Southeast and your church worldwide, for the church in Iran. I pray that we would not shrink back, that we would hold tighter to your promises, that we would hold tighter to your word, that we would go deeper with you in everything that we are. God, you are so good to us. We thank you for your blood that covers a multitude of sins. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together and sing this great hymn that Mike shared, Nothing But the Blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood.
This next hymn we're going to sing before Mike comes up, it's called There Is a Fountain, and it was written in 1771, centuries ago. It was written by a guy named William Cooper, who struggled with depression all through his life. And I'm thinking about Mike and what he shared and how he must be faithful and not looking back, but looking forward. And this guy, this author of the song, William Cooper, ended up in a hospital. to deal with his depression. And at one point, he was going to become a lawyer, and he got to his interview, and he was struck down with a panic attack, which sent him spiraling into greater depression. And later in his life, his brother died, which he struggled so mightily to deal with. And at one point in his life, he tried to take his life. Not once, not twice, but three times. And each time something happened and prevented him from that. And he felt like God wanted him to live, right? And he went on to write this hymn, "There is a fountain filled with blood." So as we sing this, and as Mike steps up in a moment to lead us through communion, wherever you are, if you're in a personally uncertain time, time struggling with your emotions and struggling with the future, let's not look back, but let's look to Christ, amen, to give us hope, right? To give us something solid to stand upon and to trust in, because our sins are forgiven, right? There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and the sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoices to see that fountain in his day. As he washed all my sins away, washed all my sins away, washed all my sins away. And there may I live as he wash all my sins away. Dear dying, my precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransom cries of God be said to sin.
Hello? This is the time of our service when we reflect on the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those of you that are at home, please take a moment to prepare your elements. If you are worshiping with us in person and did not take a prepackaged communion, please do so now. If you feel that you are not right with God, go to Him now. Now is the time for us to turn our hearts to Him in prayer. I also ask that you would go to God in prayer, praying for somebody who does not have a relationship with Jesus yet. Ask God for their hearts to be receptive to the gospel and an opportunity for you to share the good news with them. As they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take it and eat it. This is my body. Please take the bread now." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is the blood that establishes the covenant. It is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Please take your juice now." Will you pray with me? Father, help us to remember as we receive these elements the great sacrifice that Jesus provided for us going to the cross on our behalf. I ask God that you would teach us how to live in unity and fellowship with one another and keep us from doing anything out of selfish ambition, but rather teach us humility of heart. We love you, Father, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. This is the time of our service when we receive the offering. If you are in person with us, there are trays for the offering and waste baskets for your communion cups as you exit the sanctuary today. If you're worshiping with us, you can give by going to www.southeast.cc/give. If you are someone you know that is in the need of assistance during this time, please visit our community care page on the website. Don't forget to fill out your online communication card. We would love to know that you worshiped with us today. If you'd like more information on our Bible studies or being baptized, you can mark those boxes online, and we will be in touch with you shortly. If you have a child who is missing the children's ministry class, jump in our kids Zoom call. They will meet right after the worship service every Sunday. The link to the meeting can be found on the updates page in the website. If you have a student's 6th through 12th grade, our student ministry is resuming meetings today. Awesome. They will be meeting here at the church this Sunday at 6:00. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Have a great day, and God bless.